श्री संजय अग्रवाल जी, सेक्रेटरी डिपार्टमेंट ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर एंड कोऑपरेशन, गवर्नमेंट ऑफ इंडिया, मिस्टर प्रसाद, प्रिंसिपल एडवाइज़र इन मिनिस्ट्री ऑफ एग्रीकल्चर, मिस्टर जॉनस्टन, मिस्टर बोध, आवर गेस्ट फ्रॉम इंटरनेशनल ऑर्गेनाइजेशन एंड डिफरेंट कंट्रीज, officials of Ministry of Agriculture, agriculture economists from agroeconomic research centers, and stalwarts of agriculture economics profession. I see a couple of them present in room today, and accordingly look forward to very exciting discussion in the technical session. Friends, before I come to my special address and technical issues, I would like to continue with what Secretary Agriculture mentioned. And I would like to say that for nearly 20 years, agriculture economists of this country have seen very frustrating movements. These have been frustrating movements because whatever agriculture economists have been suggesting to government, it has hardly been followed. Economists have made suggestions about what we should do to subsidy. They have made suggestions about how we deal with MSP. They have made suggestion about changing regulations. But despite, I would say, a unanimous view on many of those issues, you hardly find much action among the policymaker or among the ruling political class to follow their recommendation and to follow their suggestions. But today, I'm not saying so because I'm now also part of the system, but I'm realizing it, so that's why I'm sharing it. It looks like that situation has turned very, very favorable. And I find that today, the people who take decisions are very receptive to what agriculture economists have been suggesting, what recommendation they have been making. And I would say that we must take advantage of this opportunity. We should take advantage of this opportunity because you know that all government, they have desire to do something, particularly in a democracy, because if you don't have desire to do something, so next time coming to power, very difficult. So this desire was there in the past also. The difference which I am seeing is that now there is a desire to take action also to achieve that desire. That make a lot of difference. The constitution of high power committee of chief minister and many other things being discussed in PMO level. Yesterday also we discussed about DVT in fertilizer and all technology application in crop insurance, coming with PM Kisan. You just find that really there is a movement toward change. The second factor which is favorable for us agriculture economists is that the Secretary of Agriculture, who will spearhead most of these changes, is again a person of action. He is a person of delivery. And he doesn't have any, I would say, ideological background or rigidity that this or that thing doesn't have to be done. So he has already aptly demonstrated his capability when in a short time he came with the implementation of PM Kisan in a very short period, when everybody was doubtful that how it is possible before election that we will be able to give first installment to farmer. But he really made impossible possible. So I would say that we should make use of his presence in the ministry and mood of the current government to make the changes to achieve transformation of agriculture. So this kind of movement generally do not come. Last week I have a visitor from Delhi University, I will not name it. So he just asked me, okay, how does you feel? Is government accepting any of the things which you and your colleague are suggesting? So I asked him why he asked this question. He said, I asked this question because Kaushik Basu was a friend, and he once came with full frustration that we have an economist prime minister, but whatever I'm saying, hardly anything is followed. So I feel that now there is a change. Sometime it also depends upon circumstances that you can ignore something for some time, but you can't ignore it forever. So the point which I want to make is that this is a good time for us to see that whatever work we have been doing, whatever labor we have been putting in agriculture economic research. So there is a taker now, hopefully. Now coming to this forum, I would like to congratulate organizer of this forum. This is the third conference they are organizing. I regret that I could not participate in the past too, but if you look at the choice of topics which are there for this forum, I find very, very relevant. They reflect current reality, they reflect current need of Indian agriculture. So very, very important topic. So this is what a forum like this should be doing. But I would also like that one is Agriculture Outlook Forum. Second is Agriculture Outlook Activity. I feel that the kind of changes which have happened in Indian agriculture, we have been feeling a very strong need to come with agriculture outlook for agriculture. In fact, Ministry of Agriculture tried, this capacity within the ministry was not considered adequate some time back, so they even sponsored a big study to NCAR. They were doing a sort of agriculture outlook, which I would say was a beginning sort of things. But still, the kind of answer which people seek from agriculture outlook, the kind of information which Indian farmer, other stakeholders seek from agriculture outlook, that is still missing. Most of the time, we are taken by turn of situation suddenly. Every year we face some serious shock. Now you know that onion is the focus of discussion because suddenly prices of onion have increased by 2 to 3 times. That is what has happened. And we had no clue about it. Why we do not have clue about it? Because we do not have in place a mechanism where consciously we try to capture what is likely to happen in future and to come with some sort of strategy that, okay, so that this shock does not turn out to be very, very serious, it doesn't force us to take extreme measures, so we can have right kind of management strategy. If we could foresee that there is going to be shortage of onion, we could plan for some import in advance. So those are kind of strategy. So I feel that Indian agriculture has now reached a stage of high commercialization, and we are now highly integrated with international markets. So we really need to know, and we need to tell farmers, states, private trade, policy makers, our public parastatals, that this is what is likely to be demand, this is what likely to be supply, and ultimately this is what likely to be the price of different commodity, so that everybody can then adjust to the situation, and we are saved of taking extreme measures in case of agriculture. To some extent, I would say that other country which come with this outlook regularly, like in USA, in Australia, in fact USDA did it for most of the world. Even in India, if we have to look at outlook, we go to USDA site. But they are saying about how much area under sugarcane production, international situation and India situation. But I feel that if we do that on our own, that will be much, much richer, much more revealing. Learning from how USDA is doing, how Australia is doing, how OECD and FAO are doing, and then following that practice in our own country will be useful. And we have all the bare bittle. We have the kind of data which is needed. Like, I think India is one of few country where you can know on weekly basis how much is the estimated area put under important crops. We need to expand it to other crops also. Right now we have some reporting crops, we call them reporting crops. We do it, I think, for 23 or 24 crops. We need to expand it to other crops, that is need of the hours. But the fact that we are already doing it for all these 24 crops, we have a very well established system of IMD, information about rainfall. Daily, you open the India Economic Times, so you will just find that today the monsoon is 5.2% in excess of what is the normal kind of thing. So we get real time information. So we need to put in place a mechanism which can collate all this information and give us some outlook that 3 months from now, 4 months from now, which is going to be a lean period, what is the kind of situation that we are going to face. In doing that, you know that we would need to know something about what is likely to be demand, what is likely to be supply. Problems are more serious in case of supply because it is subject to year fluctuation depending upon weather and so many other kind of things. But in case of demand, you know that it does not fluctuate like supply. But since whatever is supplied has to be produced, so we see fluctuation in demand. Otherwise, if we follow the strict definition of demand, you don't see jerk in that. It moves on a smooth trend. But in India, we have one serious difficulty with demand, that except for household demand of commodities, we have no idea about what is the demand in other sources. And the demand in other sources in some cases is more than what is the demand from the household, about which we have reliable information. NSSO consumption survey is available to us every 5 years. Well-established price elasticity, income elasticity, population figures. So those are kind of things available, which help us in coming with a very reliable estimate of what will be the household demand. Since total demand consists of household demand and demand from other sources, and other sources are becoming more and more important, like in sugar, I think other sources are 65% to 75%, 70%. Household demand is only 35 or 40%, something like that. So similarly, in many other commodity, you just find that non-household demand. But since we do not have any strong latest empirical estimates, in many commodity we are still using the coefficient of 1951, that out of the total production of food grain, 10.5% is going for feed, seed, and other kind of thing. So I particularly want to appeal to Sanjay Agarwal ji, that he will be doing a great service to this country if he can prepare some one-time estimate of what is the demand in the other sources of all important food commodities, then that estimate can continue for another 10 years. But right now we have estimate of only 1950-51, or some individual researcher have made some suggestions which you find is not relevant to sometime to what you see on the ground. Then I come to the topic which is selected for this forum, that is universal basic income, challenge in agriculture and opportunity in agriculture. I will be brief because subsequently we will be discussing all these in technical session in more details. So coming to universal basic income for farmers, I feel that when the organizer wrote universal basic income for farmer, but they meant why it is in fact some sort of direct support to the farmer or income to the farmer. Otherwise, if you are using word universal, it doesn't go with basic income for farmers. Universal is not sectoral, universal is always universal. And if suppose we are talking about universal income for farmers, we need to prepare then a strong case. Why universal income for farmers? Why not for laborers? Because if we apply principle of equity and social justice, it is the agriculture laborer where income is lowest, whose livelihood is more vulnerable, where poverty incidence is 30-40% higher than what is poverty incidence among cultivators. So in the economic ladder, cultivators are not in the bottom strata. Bottom strata is labor people. So they are first to deserve any kind of move like providing or ensuring basic income to everyone, then farmer and then other categories. So I feel that this universal basic income for farmers, we need to have a look at it going strictly by the meaning of universal basic income. And if we are talking of universal basic income, it can't be only for farmer. It has to be for a much larger section of Indian society. Particularly, we need to consider that how we are bringing labor also into its fold. But probably, the underlying intention seems to be that can we think of putting together subsidies and giving some sort of income support to the farmer so that he get a smooth flow of income. The second problem to which Sanjay Agarwal ji found some very practical solution when he implemented PM Kisan, that is around who is farmers. You see, this is a serious issue in case of India, that who is a farmer. Generally, be considered a person who is owning agriculture land as a farmer. Then, if you are talking of giving income, you can again prepare a subset of it because certain person may not deserve it. Like I am also having agriculture land and doing some farming. Like me, many other in this hall who are having a lot of income in service, salaries. So though in some sense they are farmer because they have a landholding, they have a land, but they are not dependent on income from agriculture alone. Their major source of income may be something else. So who is a farmer in general sense of farmer and for different purpose, what is the definition of farmer that we will be using? Like for PM Kisan, the definition used is any person who own agriculture land is a Kisan, but this income that is being given to farmer will not be given to many of those who are like having pension, doing job. So you develop an exclusive criteria to just keep some sort of other people. But I feel that we need substantial improvement over this concept. First, because there are large number of people, though in terms of percent they may be small, that they do not own the land they cultivate. Though Indian researchers know it, the so-called tenant category, that those who lease in land undertake cultivation. So if they have some land of their own, they will be entitled for PM Kisan, but if they are purely agriculture laborer and then doing farming, then they will not be entitled. So there are complications like this. The other problem with the giving income to the farmer is that if you are giving attractive amount to the farmers, then you are also creating incentive for non-farmer to become farmers. And if you do not define any minimum amount, it will be very tempting for any person to buy 100 square meter of land and say, I also have agriculture land, so you give this income to me also. So these are the complications around farming, and I find that the best way to define a farmer is as done by NSSO surveys, not even by agriculture census. Recently, I discovered that agriculture census doesn't consider people working in livestock or workforce, vendry, people working in fishery as cultivator or agriculture labor, they do not consider. Recently, I discovered it. Thanks to my colleague, Shivinder Srivastav, we were writing a paper. So we discovered when we were looking at this definition. But NSSO survey, I find, is fairly reliable. It uses right kind of concept. It take into account how much major time is spent in different activity, and activity is not restricted to crop sector. It also includes livestock and fishery. So fairly elaborate kind of concept is there. So this was second issue in case of basic income, which is important. The last point related to this direct benefit support, which can be taken as a somewhat weaker synonym of universal basic income, and thinking is moving into that direction. Again, technically speaking, income and subsidies are totally two different things. And the difference between two is that subsidy has a life. Subsidy is never created to continue forever, like fertilizer subsidy. So why fertilizer subsidy was given? Because when Green Revolution came, Indian farmers were not using, they were not used to use chemical fertilizer. So just to encourage them, just to incentivize them to go for it. But problem with subsidy is that though they are required to have a life, they try to become permanent. Very difficult to get out of those. We are seeing it in case of fertilizer. We are seeing it in case of power. And wherever you give, that you can give it, but you can't withdraw it. And that could be the reason, to my mind, that you treat subsidy as a part of the income. Though while doing so, the purpose of subsidy get defeated, because subsidy is meant to increase production. Whereas income is required to what Sanjay ji explained, that why we need to give 6,000 rupees to farmer under PM Kisan. So that is just to improve his economic condition, to reduce his vulnerability, and those kind of things. So again, technically, there is a clear differentiation between subsidy and income. But since subsidies do not stop after they serve the purpose for which they were created, so this could be the biomedia that, okay, by clubbing those with the income, you can then just get rid of subsidy. So this is something which came to my mind related to universal basic income. I think I should not be taking much of the time.